Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of Known Dead by Donald Harstad, narrated by Ron McLarty. This work is copyrighted 1999 by Donald Harstad. This recording is copyrighted 2000 by Recorded Books Incorporated. No one knows the underbelly of Nation County, Iowa, better than Deputy Sheriff Carl Houseman. But with 1,300-odd miles of hills and curves to negotiate in the county's 750 square miles, there's only so much territory he can cover in an 8-hour shift. Time passes slowly riding alone, but when lives are measured in seconds and backup could be hours away, one false move can get a cop killed. And now, Known Dead.
Chapter 1. My name is Carl Houseman. I'm a deputy sheriff in Nation County, Iowa. I'm also the department's senior investigator and senior officer to boot. I'm getting a little sensitive about senior and elder being interchangeable terms. I turned 50 recently. It's gotten to the point that people ask me whether AARP sells cut-rate ammunition to older cops. Anyway, I'd like to tell you about the killings we had in our county in the summer of 96 and the subsequent investigation that stood the whole state on its ear. This is my version of what happened. It's the right one. It all started for me on June 19, 1996, about 1,500 hours. I had pretty much assigned myself as pickup car for a team of two officers who were conducting surveillance on a cultivated marijuana patch we'd located in Basel State Park. Basel's a large park, about 25 square miles, in steep hills, and just about completely covered with thick woods. At 0458, Special Agent Bill Kellerman, Iowa Division of Narcotics Enforcement, and our deputy, Ken Johansson, had been inserted into the park, being dropped off by one of the night cars. The patch itself was located some distance from the road, in a little valley. I'd never been there, but I knew the general location. I'd done surveillance on patches in the past and was very glad not to have to do this one. It was hot, it was dull, and it was seldom successful. Bill and Ken were good officers, although they both had only a couple of years of dope experience and were pretty anxious to bust this patch. The cultivated area had been observed during a flyover by a Huey helicopter provided by the Iowa National Guard, under a marijuana eradication program. Ken had been in the chopper when they first discovered the patch wedged in a deep valley and reported the event to Bill, the Iowa Division of Narcotics Enforcement agent, assigned to work undercover in the area. They'd gone in, discovered over 100 plants, and decided to go for the bust. The whole purpose of the exercise was to lie in wait and catch the owner of the patch as he or she came into the area to water and tend the plants. We had no idea who that was, though there was some speculation. I'd picked a hilltop location for my car, about a mile and a half from the two officers in the patch. I couldn't see them, but I could see a large chunk of the park, and the height of my location would ensure that I could receive their walkie-talkie transmissions in the hilly terrain. I'd gone up a long farm lane to an abandoned barn and parked in the bit of shade the barn offered. It was a slow day, and I had gotten into position early. Been there for over an hour, in fact. Quality time. It was 94 degrees, and the humidity was about 95%. I'd turned off the engine and air conditioner, so I would make less noise, and sat there trying to use thread to rig a spar for a ship model I was building. I'd given up smoking and was wishing I hadn't. I had started sweating and was wishing I hadn't, too. I'd opened one of four cans of soda pop I'd brought with me in a small ice-filled cooler. One for each of us when I picked them up, and a spare for now. I had the driver's door propped open, hoping for a little air. Not even a hint of a breeze. And they shouldn't be ready for pickup for a good half hour yet. I started the first knot in the thread that attached the stunzel boom to the spar. I heard a faint pop, then another, then a whole lot of popping noises, almost like an old lawnmower. I put down the spar and looked over toward the valley where the patch was. It was very quiet. The slight haze caused the distant features to dance. I checked both sides of the thin ribbon of graveled road that wound toward the pickup point, but I couldn't pin down where the sounds had come from. There were lots of farms surrounding the park, and I thought it was probably a tractor. I was just starting to pick up my spar when the popping began again. A lot of it. I dropped the spar and got out and stood alongside my car. I couldn't see anything out of the ordinary. It got very quiet again. "Maitland 4!" my car radio blared and nearly scared me to death. No answer. Dispatch probably hadn't heard him, down in his tree-filled hole. 4 was the call sign of Johansson. He was transmitting on the AID channel as instructed. He sounded out of breath and excited. Did they have the suspect? I began to suspect that the popping sound had been a four-wheeler. I picked up my mic and went on a different channel from 4. "Maitland 3," I said. 4 has traffic on AID. "Unable to copy him, 3," came the soft feminine reply. I was starting my engine and closing the door. I figured they'd need transport now for sure. "Maitland, 4 on AID. He sure sounded excited. I headed the car down the rutted lane as fast as I could. Maybe the suspect had fled and would be heading toward a vehicle parked somewhere on the gravel road that snaked through the base of the hills. "He's got traffic, Maitland," I said. He couldn't hear me on the info channel, which was fine, as I didn't want to interfere with his talking to the base station on the AID channel. She heard him on his third attempt. "Go ahead, 4. "Maitland, this is 4. This is 1033. I repeat, 1033. We've been hit. Automatic weapons 688 is shot. I need assistance. Fast." A brief pause. 4, she said pretty calmly. "I copy 1033, 1032. One officer down. 10-4. "Maitland, all cars, 1033, Basel State Park, 1032, officer down, possible automatic weapons." I punched up AID as I slid out of the farm lane onto the gravel. Shot? 688? Shot? 4, 3's on the way, about a mile out. I hit the siren and lights on my unmarked car and floored it while trying to fasten my seatbelt. The siren was to let anybody who was thinking about doing any more harm know help was on the way. Just maybe they'd back off. The little red light on the dash was for insurance purposes in case I hit anybody. So was the belt. I heard a garbled transmission with the word 3 in it from Johansson. The damned hills were giving me problems as I came down into the valley. Shot? Jesus, Mary and Joseph. It hadn't rained for a while, and the dust plume behind my car was extremely dense. If somebody shot a cop, they were going to leave and in a hurry. I thought I should be able to follow their dust. I slid around the biggest curve onto the old wooden bridge deck, just about lost it on the wood, came off into a dip that just about broke the shocks, and got into the short, straight stretch where the marijuana patch valley met the road. I slid to a stop. No dust, except mine, which came boiling up from behind me and blocked my view up the valley. No dust. I could see for almost an eighth of a mile. No dust, no cars, no four-wheelers. 3's 1023, I said, letting both Maitland and Johansson know I was at the pickup point. I grabbed my walkie-talkie and shut down the car as I got out. "Come up the valley, 3, said Johansson, sounding unnaturally quiet. "Be careful. They got machine guns. I think they're still around." Christ. I opened the trunk of the car and got out my AR-15 and 330-round magazines. dopers with machine guns? Around here? What the hell had the team gotten into? I was in blue jeans, blue t-shirt, and white tennis shoes, with my handgun on my right hip. Not exactly camouflage wear. I grabbed my dark blue ball cap with the logo USS Carl Vinson, CVN 70, in yellow letters. Not my choice of clothes to sneak through the woods after heavily armed suspects. I reached back into the trunk and pulled out an old rubberized green rain jacket and put it on. That'd help. Shot? I fumbled with the little first aid kit they give us. I'd need that. I looked at the ballistic vest in the trunk. It was white. Its strap-on carrier was white. And as a joke, I'd drawn a series of concentric circles over the middle in red marker. It was too hot to wear on days like this, so I kept it in a garbage bag in the trunk. I hesitated a second. If I were to put it on, I'd have to do it under my shirt and raincoat. I started up the valley without it and contacted Johansson on my walkie-talkie. Where you at, for? There was a pause, and then he whispered, straight up, about 150 yards, then off to the right. Stay on the path. After a moment, be careful. No kidding. I felt like a light bulb in a well. As I trotted about 50 yards up the gentle slope, the grass had gotten deeper, and the underbrush had closed in on both sides, forming the beginnings of a narrow path. I'd gone around 25 yards when I realized that staying on the path might not be a good idea. I moved a bit to my right, into the underbrush. I stopped. Shit. Underbrush my ass. The crap was over 6 feet tall, and most of the stalks, stems, and branches were as big around as my finger. This was not going to work, not at all. It would take an hour to go through the brush, and I'd sound like a herd of elephants. Johansson was right. Stay on the path, and try to be as quiet as I could. Maybe a smaller herd of elephants. Damn. Back on the path, I slowed way down, trying to pick up any sign of a shooter. Not much chance of that, and I really began regretting leaving my vest back at the car. Another 30 yards or so, and I took off the raincoat. I was drenched in sweat, and my heart was pounding. My breath was becoming more and more labored, as much from allergies and humidity as the exertion. I just dropped the raincoat alongside the trail. I continued, but it slowed to a cautious walk. Shot. I just couldn't believe it. Three! Where you at? Came crackling from my walkie-talkie. Johansson. I turned the volume down. Just about there, four. I was panting. Nerves, exertion, sinuses. Just about. Okay. It might be clear. I can't hear them moving around at all. He was whispering now. Okay. I whispered too. Them. Not him. Them. And if you can't hear them, it doesn't mean they're gone. And it sure as hell doesn't mean they can't hear you. He's dead. What? He was whispering, and it was difficult to understand him. Repeat. Dead. He's dead. Hurry up. He was whispering. Dead? Who's dead? Kellerman. He's dead. I had really slowed by now, from both exertion and caution. My pulse was making so much noise in my ears that I wouldn't be able to hear a horse on the path. I stopped and caught my breath, moving carefully off the trail and into the brush as I did so. 5 feet from the trail, and I was invisible, even standing up. So, of course, was anybody else. I tried to catch my breath and adjust to the situation. Dead. Oh, boy. One dead state narcotics officer, a well-armed deputy sheriff somewhere up the trail who was scared, and an unknown number of hostile dope growers armed to the teeth somewhere in the woods. I took a very deep breath. And me. Didn't want to forget me. After a second or two, I heard a thumping sound, starting up the trail and going by me and off down the trail toward the road at what seemed like 100 miles an hour. I brought my rifle up to my shoulder and froze. Silence.
Three, are you moving?
Don't talk to me now, Ken. I have to lower my rifle to use my walkie-talkie. But it was a question he had to have answered. Negative. No, not moving, I whispered. You? My voice sounded funny, and my throat was dry. Rifle back up.
Negative.
Great. If he wasn't moving, and I wasn't. I waited a few seconds, but there was no more noise. I found my left hand on the pistol grip of my assault rifle, almost cramping. I took a deep breath and slowly stepped onto the narrow trail. I stopped. I looked both ways, but saw nothing. Total silence. For the first time, I doubled over and began to move very slowly up the little dirt track. It curved to the right. I knelt down on one knee just at the bend and listened. Nothing. It was really hard to force myself to get back up and go around that blind curve. I stayed bent over and very cautiously started into the bend. The shots just about deafened me. I threw myself into the brush, landing on my right side in the damp dirt and grass. Bits of shredded leaves were slowly falling around me, and dust motes filled the air. Then, silence. Chapter 2. The quiet in the woods seemed even quieter after the explosion of noise. I moved my legs slightly. I wasn't hit. After a couple of seconds, it stopped raining leaf bits. I realized I was holding my breath and let it out slowly. The shots, three or four of them, must have been high. Then I remembered the tops of the bushes were just over my head. Not that high.
Carl!
Came a whisper on the walkie-talkie.
Carl!
Cautiously, I reached down and brought the little radio up to my mouth. I wanted to scream at him to shut up, but I knew he needed information. Yeah, go ahead, I whispered back.
They're still here, came the whispered voice. Be careful.
No shit. Thanks for filling in the gaps.
Where are you now?
He asked, in a barely discernible whisper. Right at a sharp bend to the right, I whispered back, the best I could do. There was a long pause.
Come on ahead, I'll cover you. We're just past the bend.
Fine. Why didn't you cover me before?
10-4,
I whispered. Yeah, come on ahead, sure. All I had to do was force myself to get up, at least into a crouch. That was difficult, because all my instincts told me to keep down and still. But I had to get to Johansson. He needed assistance. When I got to my feet, I found I was only about one step off the trail. Very carefully, I stepped out. I stopped, crouched down, and looked around, my rifle pointing ahead of me. Nothing. But I didn't have my first aid kit. Where in the hell had I lost it? I backed back into the tall brush and glanced down. It was to my right. Holding my rifle in my left hand, I picked the metal kit up and stuffed it partway down the front of my jeans. Both hands on the rifle again. I got back on the trail.
Carl, I heard from the walkie-talkie. You coming, Carl?
I didn't bother to answer, because I would have had to take one hand off my rifle again to do so, and I was feeling eyes on me all the time. Instead, I crept around the corner to the right, about four steps into it, and I saw them. Johansson was about a foot off the trail, kneeling by a body that had to be Kellerman, although I could only see his lower half. They were both in camouflage clothes, and Johansson was as white as a sheet. They were shielded a little by a grassy mound about 2 feet high and a dead tree that stretched into the brush just past them. There were several pale blue paper wrappers strewn on the ground. First aid kit compresses. They reminded me of flowers. I was to them in 2 steps and knelt back down just off the trail.
You all right?
Yeah, said Johansson. His eyes were wild-looking, and his head was moving constantly, scanning the area.
They fucking killed us, man. They killed us.
Shock does strange things. I moved slightly and reached out to try to find a carotid pulse on Kellerman. Johansson blocked my hand.
He's dead.
Just let me check, Ken, just for the record. He thought for a second.
Yeah, okay.
I reached out and pressed 2 fingers into Kellerman's neck. Nothing. Cool to the touch, but damp. His color and texture reminded me of pale cheese. I noticed he hadn't shaved that morning. Okay, I said softly. I wiped my hand on my jeans and pulled the first aid kit out before it cut me in half. What happened? I asked, keeping my eyes focused opposite Johansson's, peering uphill. It occurred to me that, crouched down as we were, we couldn't see much more than a few feet except uphill and up the trail.
You sure you're all right?
We got set up, he said. They were waiting for us, just waiting. No, I didn't get hit. I'm just fine.
Off in the distance, a fragment of a siren's wail came drifting up the little valley.
I'm sorry, man, said Johansson to me.
Nothing for you to be sorry about, I said, scanning the area around us. I was thinking the siren might stir up the ambushers. This shit can happen.
Yeah, I do. I am, I mean, he said softly.
I kept looking up the slope. There could be a tank up there, and I wouldn't be able to see it unless it moved. Why? I asked, almost absently, trying to humor him.
It was me that shot at you just now. I thought you might be them.
I looked at him. Oh. I looked back uphill. Apology accepted. Sort of.
I didn't mean to, he said.
No problem. I just wasn't going to think about that. How many you mean by they? I asked.
Lots.
Right. The siren was Lamar Ridgway, Nation County Sheriff, and my boss for more than 15 years. He was a good sheriff, dedicated and tireless. He was also the only other one working today, and had come all the way from Maitland. It's a big county we live in. People don't seem to realize just how big, or how few of us there are. Nation County is about half the size of Rhode Island. Now, that's not exactly huge, I admit, but there are usually 2 or 3 cops out at the most. 750 square miles is a big area.
3 or 4. Can you copy me now?
Lamar's voice has a raspy quality to it, unmistakable. I picked up my walkie-talkie. We copy one, I answered him.
Where you at?
The question of the hour. I looked over at Johansson. Did you brief one as to how to get up here?
Yeah, he said. We showed him the aerial photos.
I held my walkie-talkie to my lips. 1, 3. Up the trail. Wait, if you can, for some more backup before you come up. We might have shooters in the area. I knew he wouldn't, any more than I had. I just had to say it.
Yeah, 10-4. What's going on up there? Somebody shot?
Yeah, I answered. I turned my head to look at Johansson, who was getting a dazed look about him. I brought the walkie-talkie back up. 688 is down.
Need an ambulance?
Asked Lamar, hopefully.
Negative, I said. Medical examiner. 10-4.
I looked at Johansson. You able to wait for a bit more?
Yeah.
We're fine here right now, one, I said to Lamar. I hoped I was telling the truth, but I sure didn't want Lamar charging up to the rescue and getting blown away for his trouble. But let us know when you start up the trail. We're about 150 yards up, and just kind of off the trail to the right. We won't be able to see you until you're right on us. I glanced at Johansson. I knew about that hazard, all right.
10-4, said Lamar. I got people coming from all over. Be there right quick.
I nudged Johansson. You got a canteen or something? Could use a drink. The heat was oppressive, and there seemed to be even less air here than before. For some reason, the whispering made it seem even hotter. Yeah, he said, reaching behind his hip and unfastening the GI canteen. Here. I took a long swig. It was warm but wet. I thought about the 3 cans of diet soda in my car and the ice-filled cooler. I handed it back to him. You better have some, too.
No,
he said, shaking his head. I'm all right. And his voice trailed off as he looked around the brush again. Drink some, I said. Don't want you going into shock or anything. We got enough trouble without that. In the distance, there were more sirens. Johansson swallowed water from his canteen loudly. He sighed and said, At least we got one of them.
What?
Yeah, Kellerman got one of them. He's up there, he said, gesturing up the trail. Just a little ways.
Dead?
Oh, yeah, he said. Real. There was a sudden rustling in the brush, just on the other side of the trail. I brought my rifle around just as Johansson's came up to his shoulder.
Don't fucking shoot unless we got a target, I hissed.
Right, he whispered. He wasn't convinced. It couldn't be Lamar, not yet, and not from over there. We waited, in dead silence, for several seconds. Sweat ran off my left cheek, which was pressed against the buttstock of my AR, dripped onto my left hand and ran down my forearm. I don't remember ever being so tense. Nothing. Then a ground squirrel chattered, and there was a faint rustling again. We relaxed a bit, but didn't talk. It was about 2 more minutes when Lamar's voice crackled over the radio. I sort of jumped.
Okay, I'm coming up. I should be about there.
10-4, I said into the walkie-talkie. Way to go, Lamar. I knew you wouldn't wait. Be careful. But there has not, I repeat, not been any activity for 10 minutes or so. But keep your eyes open. And at least I won't shoot at you until I know who you are, I thought. God, the idea of being blown away by Johansson sent a little shiver up my back, despite the heat. God, what a stupid way to go. Lamar appeared around the corner in uniform, with his shotgun pointing in front of him. He stopped and looked at the 3 of us.
Holy shit, was all he could say.
Chapter 3. 2 hours later, things were starting to sort themselves out and get much more complicated at the same time. Typical investigation in that you just couldn't simplify things, no matter how you tried. Lamar and I were returning up the trail after trying to direct the officers who were beginning to search the park. He and I had just gone back through the yellow crime scene tape and past the hurriedly arriving media. I overheard some reporter, who had set up his own camera and was speaking into it, say, There are known dead so far, but how many is still not certain. They're all known to somebody, I said to Lamar.
What?
His hearing was going. Never mind. Known dead. I didn't know how else to put it myself. The term just sort of offended me, with the implications of body counts and things. Known dead, like they wouldn't count somehow until they were known. We'd also been briefing various investigative people as they showed up and picking up items from our cars down on the road. The area search was a hopeless task, but it did serve to make those of us who were concerned with the crime scene feel a little more comfortable. As far as I was concerned, though, the shooters were long gone.
"Where's Johansson?" I asked Lamar. I'd lost track of him in the combined process of getting resources assigned to the scene and scrounging gear from my trunk.
"He's still up there talking to D&E and DCI. He just doesn't want to leave. He ain't hurt, but I'm going to have to get him out of here."
"Yeah, but let me talk to him again first, okay?"
"Just for a while."
I could imagine the conversation between Johansson and the Iowa Department of Narcotics Enforcement and the Iowa Division of Criminal Investigation. A state agent being murdered in the woods was bad enough, but to have heavily armed and unknown suspects to boot. Shit, they were just sitting on a patch, Lamar. What went wrong?
"I don't know," Lamar said, stopping and turning around. "I thought you might."
"Hell," I said. "I haven't worked dope for 5 or 6 years. I don't even know who they thought they might have."
That was very true. We worked all dope cases that way within the department. Need to know only.
I was our intelligence officer, but I wouldn't pressure them for the information unless I thought they might have something I needed. Lamar, as sheriff, had automatic need to know, but seldom asked.
"Oh,"
he said. He sounded a little disappointed and turned back up the trail.
"But I'll know shortly," I said. "Just a minute."
Since we were stopped, I took a spray can of insect repellent out of my camera bag. I sprayed it liberally on my face, hands, inside my hat, inside my shirt, on my waist, and finally on my ankles. As I was replacing the can, Lamar spoke.
"Got something against bugs?"
"Yeah," I said as we started back up the long, winding path to the crime scene. "I hate chiggers and mosquitoes." I reached back into my camera bag. "You want some?"
"Nope. Never used the stuff. Bugs gotta eat, too."
It occurred to me to look for my raincoat, which I'd tossed aside on the way to help Johansson. The fact that it was an olive green wasn't gonna be a lot of help, but it should have stood out because of its shape, if nothing else. I couldn't find it, and made a mental note to look again when we came back. We hit the crime scene proper about 2 minutes later. You really have to have worked a crime scene in the deep woods with the temperature hovering around 100 and the humidity in the high 90s to appreciate what a pain in the ass it can be. This one looked like it was scattered out over an area like a little plane wreck. Most of the activity was centered just up the path from where I'd encountered Johansson with the body of Kellerman. There was one strand of yellow crime scene tape winding its way from the path off to my right, disappearing into the bushes. Another went away to my left and uphill, disappearing into the trees. They weren't being used as barriers, but rather to indicate paths or tracks. Other tape was screening off small areas on both sides of the path. There was a large area to the left where the underbrush gave way to grass. That whole area was festooned with little white boxes covering small items of evidence. There seemed to be at least 100 of them, maybe more. Then there were small tags marking photo locations. Lots of those, too. Plus, there were about 5 lab people there, as well as 3 Division of Criminal Investigation agents and the deputy state medical examiner. And 2 young officers, a deputy from another county and a state trooper I didn't know, standing uncertainly around on what appeared to be a perimeter, looking a little nervous, but still spending most of their time looking at the scene through their dark glasses rather than scanning for possible bad guys in the bush. Hester Gorse, my favorite DCI agent, was there. Hester and I had worked together before, and I had a lot of confidence in her. She was kneeling down over a matted area in the underbrush, which contained a lump under a yellow disposable blanket. The medical examiner was standing beside her, pulling off a set of latex gloves. Hester looked up as we approached and smiled.
"What we got here?" asked Lamar.
"We're not sure," said Hester.
But it looks like maybe the doper shot at Bill. Bill shot and killed the doper. And then the doper's friends shot and killed Bill.
Hell, that ought to clear up who was involved then, said Lamar.
It flashed through my mind that there's no such thing as an open and shut case. Little did I know. Well, not really, said Hester. Something about this just isn't adding up.
Okay.
Johansson has told us a lot, she said, but we need to know a lot more.
Where is he?
Asked Lamar. He and two DNE people are up toward the end of this valley. Hester stood and winced.
Almost as old as you, Houseman,
she grinned. And you were the first one at the scene?
Naturally.
Good. Let's get you together with the DNE troops, then. She took off her gloves and shook her hands to get the sweat off. DNE. Also good. They could tell me a lot about who was growing what up here. And just about on cue, there was a crunching noise up to the north, and two people I didn't know came into view, with Johansson between them. He saw Lamar and me and started over. The two DNE folks, whom I didn't recognize, hung back for a second, and then decided that, whoever I was, they'd better be around when Ken talked to me, and overtook him in a couple of strides. You okay, Ken?
Jesus, Carl, it was like a fucking war.
Agent Bob Dahl, DNE,
said Agent Bob Dahl, interrupting.
Deputy Houseman, investigator, I said. You helping out here with my case?
It's always a good idea to establish the territorial limits right off the bat. Of course, I put him at a bit of a disadvantage because he wouldn't ever say that he was helping me. After all, it was a DNE officer who was dead. But it was in my jurisdiction, and we were going to be fully involved. But he knew that I knew that he was supposed to do just that, and that was what counted. I decided I was going to like him as soon as he answered.
I'm helping them, he said, indicating Hester and the rest of the Division of Criminal Investigation team. But I'll bet they're helping you. I was his partner, he said, obviously referring to Kellerman. I nodded. I'm sorry, and I'm really sorry about this, I said, gesturing at the entire scene. We'll find out who did it. I turned back to Ken. What happened, Ken? Who did this?
Ken didn't know, but he did tell me, all in a rush, that he was certain that he was taking fire from at least three different locations at once, and that he thought the dead doper was local, and that he thought Bill had shot the doper, and that the doper's associates, whom they had apparently missed when they came up, shot Bill, and he damn well knew that he hadn't killed anybody, but that he'd tried pretty damned hard.
Okay.
I was thinking about his shots at me as I came up the trail. Well, at least now I knew that he aimed a little high, thank God.
We saw this one, said Ken, gesturing at the mound under the blanket. He was just walking through the woods, came right up the path.
Okay.
Like he wasn't all that cautious, had a shotgun and that other gear with him. We saw him, then we lost him as he hit the trail.
He pointed uphill and to the right of the trail.
We were up there.
Right.
We saw him again once, and Kellerman and I decided to go get him.
Johansson looked at us, distressed.
There are two ways to the patch from here, you know?
We didn't, but we nodded just the same.
We split up, he said, and after a few seconds, I heard two shots about the same time. I thought maybe that somebody...
Johansson gulped down some water. None of us said a word.
God, it's hot, he said. I thought that he'd fired a couple of shots to get the doper to stop. I went running back and hollered, but nobody said anything. And then there were a whole bunch of shots. Jesus, there were a lot.
He'd rushed on, and as he came to where the dead doper was lying, he saw someone in camouflage clothing rise up and point a gun at him.
Shit, I thought it was Kellerman, you know?
Oh, yeah. When you're expecting to see a particular person, you see him, even if it's not them at all.
I said, it's me. And then I saw it wasn't him. and I just dove into the bushes and the son of a bitch just started shooting at me.
He shuddered.
I fucking landed on Bill, man, right across his legs. Oh, shit, I mean, he was alive.
He looked at Hester.
I hope I didn't hurt him.
He was going pale.
And
Ken looked around.
I think I better sit down,
he said. And did. Plop. We all tried to grab him at the same time, but he sat too quickly. Lamar was on us in a second, talking on his walkie-talkie.
Get me a couple EMTs up here. I have a man who needs some attention, possibly heat.
Dr. Steve Peters, the deputy medical examiner, was with Ken in about 2 seconds. We just sort of stood around looking dumb. That's what happens when you want to help and either can't or can't do anything useful. We stayed around long enough to make sure Ken was okay. I gestured with my head, and Hester stepped aside a bit with me. Okay if I look at the doper? Hester smiled. She had a great smile. I mean, it really looks like she's glad to see you. An honest smile, I suppose you'd call it. She's about 10 years younger than I am, which makes her mature enough for most anything and still young enough to do it. At about 5'6", she's also close to a foot shorter than me. Very fit, with short hair. That makes her look even younger. Just based on appearances, you wouldn't consider her much of a threat. Not unless you knew her.
Sure, Carl.
Thanks, Hester. I grinned back. I must have looked a little more stressed than I thought. Her smile faded.
This is bad business, Carl. Very bad.
You got that right. I stopped at the body. We don't know who he is? Agent Dahl spoke up. No, not yet anyway. We've checked him for ID, but there's none on him. He paused. There probably shouldn't be any anyway. I wasn't aware he'd been following us. Can I move him a bit? You should always ask to make sure all the photos are done and all the in-place data has been gathered.
Go ahead, Carl, said Hester.
She lifted the blanket. The body was a real mess. Blood had soaked his faded blue jeans, and the front of the unbuttoned shirt was so sticky it matted to his ribs. He'd been torn up from the lower belly through the side of his head, half dozen wounds at least. The head wound had pretty well removed the top of his head, making a channel as it did so that it looked like a purple smiley face with a bite out of the top. His lips puffed out, and one eye was completely gone, probably having come out under the terrific pressure that builds up with wounds like that. But I thought I recognized him. His chin, the scraggly beard, and the awful teeth. I pulled a pair of rubber gloves from my camera bag, put them on, and very gently moved the body over in a quarter roll to his left. I pulled aside his blood-soaked red and blue short-sleeved shirt. The tattoo of a skeleton on a motorcycle, hair streaming in the wind, was on his right shoulder blade. "I think this is Howie Phelps," I said, looking up at the two agents.
"You know him?"
asked Dahl. "If it's Howie, and I think it is, I busted him for dope about 10-12 years ago." That was to tell Dahl two things: that I had made dope arrests of my own, and that they had been made while Dahl was still working Capitol Security. I mean, he likely knew a lot about dope cases, maybe a bit more than I did, but I wanted him to know that we were on a pretty even playing field. I looked at Dahl. "It's true," I said, and grinned at him. "I used to hate old fart deputies who said they knew everybody and really didn't. I really do know this dude. Had an AKA of turd, if that rings any bells with you." He shook his head. "They're all turds, no bells. What kind of dope?"
"Grass and meth."
"Much?"
"No, small time. Maybe a pound of grass at a time, just enough meth to get his ego up, so to speak."
"He seems to have had a shotgun," said Hester. "Did he usually go armed?"
I looked at her. "Never, as far as I know."
"And a small water pump and a battery and some hose," she said.
That time of year, said Dahl. He was right there. The little pile of equipment would be used to pump water from a little stream up into the patch. Seems to me, I said, looking back down at the remains, that Turd here's got a girlfriend. Lives with her in Freiburg. Freiburg was about 5 miles from Basel State Park, right on the Mississippi River. Give me a while. I'll think of her name. I stared at Howie, then took out my camera and snapped a couple of shots. I put my camera back and said to nobody in particular, "That was a pretty powerful rifle." We have over 50 7.62-millimeter casings, about 30 5.56-millimeter casings, and probably a lot more to come, in 4 different locations so far, said Hester. I digested that for a moment. Those little white boxes I see everywhere? She nodded. 2 different calibers? Again, a nod. No shotgun shells? She shook her head. 4 locations. So, the dead doper had a couple of friends our guys didn't see, not till it was too late. I was just speculating. Silence. Agent Dahl? I don't know. It sure looks that way, though. Hester?
Looks like it, she shrugged. Maybe.
If that's what it is, I said, we're looking for at least 2 people. Do we know which casings are from our guys?
Not yet, said Hester. I'd bet on 3 people myself. However, there's 1 bunch of 5.56 rounds, maybe 5 to 10 of them in that general area. She pointed to some heavy underbrush down near Kellerman's body. Those are probably officers' rounds.
Okay. I turned to Dahl. Just how big is this patch, anyway? He looked at me, deciding. 106 plants. Since Amila. That gave me pause. That was grown here back in the middle 80s. DEA said it couldn't be done in this climate. I smiled. Iowa farm boys can grow just about anything on a slab of concrete. Kind of makes you proud. I'd been squatting down and stood up slowly. My back acts up on occasion, and I don't like to push my luck. I looked the area over again, sweat dripping down from my forehead. I swiped at it with my gloved hand, so it only moved around. I peeled the glove off and brushed my forehead with the back of my hand. The glove was dripping, high humidity. Hester handed me a small cloth.
You've got powder from your glove all over your forehead.
Thanks, Hester. I looked at both her and Dahl. Thing is, I can't really see Turd having this kind of patch. I mean, both quality and quantity. He wasn't bright enough to tend it properly. That stuff takes a lot of attention, doesn't it? Dahl nodded. Let alone afford it, I finished up. Alan Hummel, the special agent in charge of the DCI in our area, chose that moment to come up.
Hello, Carl.
Hi, Al.
Bad business.
Al was always brief like that. He'd been a cop for 20-some years, all of it with the state. He's a very good investigator, but it was our misfortune that he got promoted once too often. He was now an administrator. I would much rather have had him actively investigating on this one. He'd known Bill. Yeah, I looked him right in the eye. You think we have a drug war here?
I don't know.
He hesitated just a moment, and then did exactly the right thing.
I'll get a meeting set. DNE, us, you, DEA, and FBI. We'll find out.
FBI? I asked. They in on this?
Yeah. An offer of assistance.
Cool. FBI has incredible lab and scene analysis people. I suspected they were really in because of the DEA involvement. Although when an offer is made like that, you take it without asking. All of which was a convoluted way of arriving at my next point. Al, I'm not cleared on all the dope stuff anymore. I'm general criminal investigations.
You still the intelligence officer?
Yep,
that'll do.
Murders take precedence over dope cases, especially cases where a cop is killed.
at least in theory. But dope cops just hate to give up any information that's really valuable. Goes against everything they think. Reasons range from fear of jeopardizing informants to having another agency get in ahead of them and get the credit. I looked at Dahl.
You be there?
Sure.
You and Kellerman were working this one together.
Yes.
I see. That meant he was carrying quite a load himself.
Just for the record, he said, I had no idea anything like this. I mean, I would have been here for this if...
There was a long silence. Then Hester said, You'll want to take a look at Bill. We're going to have to move him soon. I hesitated for a second.
Okay.
We walked downhill on the path.
Doc's already seen him?
I needed to know if I could touch the body.
Yeah, said Hester. He's been done. Johansson found him right about there, she said, pointing at a depressed area of grass and weeds. There seemed to be quite a lot of blood.
He said that there was still shooting going on, so we dragged him up here to cover.
There was a lane of down grass with a thin trail of blood leading up to the little mound and the log where I'd first seen the two of them. A yellow emergency blanket now covered the remains of Kellerman. He'd been reduced to the lump underneath the blanket, with the little torn blue compress packets like flowers.
There's not much blood on the track up to this point, she said. Doc says he thinks that he was probably either dead or nearly so when Johansson got to him.
Dr. Peters was about 20 yards away, still with Johansson and Lamar. I really wanted him to be there when I looked at Bill, but didn't want to wait. I put on another glove.
Well, let's get on with it.
I knelt down and pulled the blanket aside. Bill was a mess. He was the whitest corpse I'd seen in a long time. Must have completely bled out. From the front, there really wasn't much remarkable, just some dents in his vest, with little holes in the center. His camo shirt had some holes in it, too. Looked like they'd been made by a pencil or something. Nothing that looked lethal. The ME had apparently undone the Velcro straps that held the vest in place. I lifted it gingerly. There was a wad of gauze wedged between his vest and his chest. Obviously a futile effort on the part of Ken to stop the bleeding. It was so pathetic, so sad, it hit me pretty hard. I just stayed hunched over the body, not looking up, not doing anything, until it passed. I took a deep breath and continued my examination. There were 5 ragged holes in his chest, starting just at the top of the sternum and traveling down and to his left. The last one had made a long, gaping rent in his side about an inch in from the entrance. They weren't in a line, but rather in a bunch that traveled together. I looked for a few moments. Full auto. Rifle, not a pistol-caliber submachine gun. And what I'd assumed to be the last round was probably the first, as the recoil of the rifle lifted its muzzle as it fired. Damned fast rate of fire, I thought, to group this close, or awfully close to the target. The holes were ragged because the bulletproof vest had stripped parts of the metal jackets off the rounds and flattened them just a bit on their way through. So when they came out of the back face of the front of the vest, they weren't quite round anymore. I dropped the vest back down on his chest and pulled the blanket back over him. It snagged on the weeds, and I tore it. I looked up at Hester.
M16? Likely, said Hester.
We've got a lot of 5.56 brass around here.
I sighed. Well, they tell you that these vests are only designed for pistol ammo. I thought for a second. What was Johansson carrying?
AR-15. Both officers were.
I stood up. We have the rifles now? I mean, all we need is for some defense attorney to say Kellerman shot himself by accident, or that Bill was shot by Ken. I shook my head. Since I knew he'd
just about shot me, that was a lot closer to reality than anybody else knew. I hope we can find some bullets to match up with the weapons.
I think there are some fragments trapped in the rear panel of his vest, said Hester.
I hope so. I took off my gloves and stuffed them in my pocket. I looked up the hill and was stunned to see two people with a still camera panning the scene, one male, one female.
Who the fuck are those people?
Everybody followed my gaze and were equally dumbfounded.
Media, said Hester. Honest to God.
I looked around, and the young deputy and trooper assigned to the security detail for the scene were standing facing the crime scene rather than looking outward. They were still the only ones at the scene wearing dark glasses, of course.
Suppose maybe Elwood and Jake there could run them off? I asked.
Hey! Yelled Al, waving uphill and getting the attention of the gawking troopers. Get those people secured right now!
It took them a second, but then they started uphill at a run. The media people tried to outrun them to the top of the hill, but were caught well before the crest. After a few moments, the whole group started down toward the crime scene.
Jesus Christ, said Al. They're bringing them back to us.
By this time, Lamar had joined us.
I'll talk to them, he said, and stomped uphill, gesturing to the troopers to keep them away from the scene.
I looked at Al and Hester. We better go with him, I said. We all knew that Lamar was really bad with the media, and not much better with junior state troopers. We also all knew that processing this scene was probably going to take well into tomorrow, and that the media weren't done out here by a long shot. We'd better get ground rules they would all have to follow.
Just me, said Al. You two are going to be working the case, and there's no point in letting them get to you, or even know who you are.
He watched Lamar trudge up the hill.
I'll let Lamar talk to him for a couple of minutes first, he grinned. Makes my job that much easier.
You love it, said Hester. She wiped the sweat off her own forehead with the back of her hand. That's why you look so pretty.
He grinned, but she was right. Of all the people at the crime scene, only Al looked cool. He had removed his suit coat and carefully rolled his pale blue shirt sleeves up two rolls and barely loosened his navy blue tie. There was just a hint of perspiration on his shirt. Shirt sleeves, mind you. Sleeves. How's he do that? I asked Hester as he began moving uphill.
What? Walk without falling over?
No, damn it, always looks so neat.
You'll never know, Houseman, she grinned. Back to work.
We got together with Dr. Peters and talked over what we had. Not a lot, but too much for anybody but a very meticulous lab team to make much use of. Anything at all that's unusual, Doc?
Not really, Carl. Pretty straightforward gunshot wounds, all through and through. Those vests aren't much good against high-powered rifles, are they?
A statement, not a question.
Well, they say they're only effective against pistols. Did you notice the range seems pretty short?
Yeah, I thought so, too.
Did you see any powder or tattooing?
No, but it'll be there, I'm sure of it. The clothing probably trapped most of it.
Less than 50 feet with high power? Hester asked.
I'd say so, but let's check. I'll tell you, though, any further than that, and whoever it was wouldn't be able to see a target. Not in this undergrowth.
That's one of the many things I like about Doc Peters. He does medical examining very thoroughly, and is something rare in our state, a forensic pathologist. Another thing I like about him is that he sort of takes the bite out of bad events. I don't know how, but he does. I was already distancing myself from the emotions permeating the scene, and it was talking with Doc Peters that was doing it. Being clinical helps, I guess.
Okay, look, Doc. I have to get to an interview before this thing gets all over the state. Girlfriend of the dead doper up there. So I'm sure you and the lab people will have things well in hand. DCI will provide autopsy coverage. That meant an officer to witness the proceedings and take photos.
Every effort would be made to have an officer who didn't know Kellerman do the work.
Oh, yes.
So if it's all right with Hester here, maybe she could come with me for the interview. It's always good practice to have a woman officer present when you interview a female. In fact, sometimes it's better to have her do the interview.
Sure, said Doc.
Fine, said Hester. So, I said, let's meet later. We had to run a small press gauntlet on the way down from the scene. I tried to think of a way around the little media cluster, but there were thick woods on both sides of our path until we hit the meadow just off the road. Trapped.
Officer, can you tell us what happened up there?
Officer, were any of the victims police officers? Can you confirm that there is an officer involved?
Did this happen today, or is this a discovery of old bodies?
That was original. I kind of like that one. And then, of course,
can you confirm the known dead? How many known dead?
It rankled. Hester, fortunately, was quite adept at this sort of thing.
An official statement will be issued in a short while, thank you.
I glanced at her as we got into my car. Who's going to issue a statement?
Don't know, she said, slamming a door. Not me.
On the way into Freiburg, in the blessed air conditioning of my car, Hester and I discussed just what we had, or more precisely, didn't have. So we agree that our people received fire from three separate locations.
At least, said Hester.
She leaned back in the seat and put her feet up on the dashboard, clasping her knees with her arms, but not necessarily simultaneously.
Oh? Nope. The two 762-millimeter locations could be the same shooter, and he moved.
What did Ken say about that?
I don't think he got that far.
I stopped at the stop sign, then turned off the gravel and onto a blacktop road. That scenario fit just about exactly with the faint popping I'd heard from near the barn on the hill.
So that leaves us with two, possibly three suspects.
Or more, I said. In firefights, not everybody always shoots.
What, are you being difficult?
I grinned. No, just thinking. We drove in silence for a few moments.
Can I ask you a personal question?
Sure,
she said. Do you feel anything special? I mean, with an officer involved and dead? She thought for a second.
No, not really.
Me either, I said. I looked over at her. Should I be worried about this? I mean, I knew everybody up there, even the doper.
No, Carl, don't worry. You've had years to build up the defenses. Look on the bright side. They work.
She had a point, although I thought that I should have felt more. We went a couple of miles in silence.
So, said Hester, just what do we want to know from this girl we're going to see?
All the usual stuff.
No, what do we really want to know?
Well, I said, passing a pickup truck. Maybe why Howie was there in the first place, for starters.
I'd rather know why he came back after he saw the officers yesterday.
What?
She smiled. Thought that'd get your attention.
You gotta be kidding.
Nope. He even left them a note. Fuck you, pig, or something like that.
You sure?
That's what Dahl said. But Ken said that the doper was in camo yesterday. He sure wasn't today.
Camo? Turd?
Yeah.
No, I said. No, never happened. He'd never wear something like that. Especially not to go tend to Patch. Too much attention.
I glanced at Hester. She was giving me the old one-raised eyebrow look.
Really?
I said. Maybe a bit on the defensive.
You his dad or something?
He was a snitch for me for a while.
Do you any good?
Two defendants.
Over how long?
None of your business.
Humph,
she snorted.
Not much of a snitch.
Hey, we do what we can.
So, she said, you think he's got a partner?
Probably not. But this girlfriend might think so.
Chapter 4.
Freiburg is a town of some 700 or 800 souls, sandwiched between 100-foot bluffs and the Mississippi River. It just fits. 5 streets, 2 of which are the main highway as it enters from the west and leaves to the north. The one that comes down the bluff eventually becomes Main Street as it heads toward the river. A double line of red and orange brick 2-story buildings, 2 blocks long, commercial businesses with apartments above. None built after 1903, according to the date and logo on most of the buildings. The only remodeling of the apartments after the 1930s had been all cosmetic. Most of it had occurred in the late 1960s and consisted of drywall and dropped ceilings, all of which was now over 30 years old and hadn't been treated too well the last 10 years. Beth Harper, a.k.a. Slick, the one true love of the late Howie Phelps, lived in one of the apartments on the north side of the street, just about the middle of the second block, up a very long flight of stairs, 34 steps I counted as we went. I just do that sort of thing. Dark stairwell with either a burned-out bulb or a blown fuse. Either way, nobody apparently had done anything about it. We got to the top and into a long, dim hallway, cluttered with those big, bright-colored, inflated-looking plastic toys like tricycles, balls, bats, and wagons, the kind little kids have that look like they came out of a cartoon strip. Then a long line of full black garbage bags. Beth lived in the second apartment, with the view of the trash bins that nobody in this building seemed to use. And it was hot in the hall, without a breath of air, and a lot of stink. I knocked on Beth's door for what seemed like half an hour. Then it opened a crack, and a young woman I didn't recognize stuck her head out. Her eyes were all red, and I thought at first that she'd been doing dope. Then I realized that she'd been crying. "What do you want?" "We'd like to talk to Beth for a minute." I held up my badge. "Fuck!" She turned back into the apartment, leaving her hand on the doorframe. "Beth, it's the fucking pigs!" Matter of fact, no animosity in particular. Like so many, she'd been raised on fucking pig being a label, just like postman, milkman, or clerk. What do you want to be when you grow up? Fucking pig. It could happen. There was a muffled response, and the door opened wider. Come on in. The apartment was worse than the hallway, and more crowded as it contained the young woman who had answered the door, Beth, and 1 2-year-old and 1 3-year-old. The 2 kids were wearing plastic pants, but otherwise were naked. Just plastic pants, no diapers underneath. Dirty, bright-eyed, they were very near their mother. Beth sat at a formica-topped kitchen table that had rusting chrome legs and 3 matching chairs with cracked vinyl seats. I could barely see the tabletop for the dirty dishes. I guess it was supposed to look like marble. "Hi, Beth."
"Mr. Houseman," she said, and took a long drag off a cigarette.
She exhaled, blowing the smoke up into her bangs, but cooling her forehead a bit.
"What did you guys do to Howie? I hear he's dead."
She was doing cool well, but her hand was shaking. "How'd you hear that?" I asked. Beth nodded toward the other young woman.
"Her mom works at the doc's office."
"Enough for now. Pursue that part later." "That's right. He's dead, Beth." She almost lost it, but didn't quite. Another drag, and she was in control. Beth has long, dark hair and very large brown eyes. She looked up at me steadily.
"Why?"
"He was shot up near his patch."
"Why'd you do it?"
"We think he shot first," I said. I turned toward the other young woman. "Why don't you take the kids out on the back porch or someplace, just for a few minutes?" She looked at Beth, who nodded in assent.
"You go with Nan, guys. That's okay. Mommy will be right here."
Between the 2 of them, they got the kids onto the porch in a minute or so.
Beth came back, ran a hand through her hair, and finally asked us to sit. We did, careful not to lean on the table.
What do you mean, he shot first? That's easy to say now that he's dead.
We have reason to believe that he did. The evidence, said Hester, points to it.
Who's she?
Agent Hester Gorse, DCI.
You here because of this, right?
That's right, said Hester.
She's okay, isn't she?
Beth asked me. You bet.
So what happened?
Well, I said, he apparently was on his way to tend his patch, and he got surprised by one of our people. Shot at him, our man shot back, just like that.
Well, he saw you guys up there yesterday. God, are you telling me the truth that he shot at you guys? For sure?
Looks like it, kid. It really does.
But he saw you guys yesterday. Why didn't you bust him then?
I don't think our people recognized him. In fact, I know they didn't, or they would have been here pretty quickly.
That's right, said Hester. And they saw him at a distance and couldn't keep with him, lost him.
Well, said Beth.
Well, then why did they have to go and kill him?
He shot at a cop. They returned fire. She stood up fast.
Oh, yeah, and I'm supposed to believe that.
You're gonna have to, I said, as evenly as I could.
Oh, sure.
She stabbed her cigarette out in a dirty paper plate.
You have any proof?
A cop was killed, too. She sat back down. Silence.
Not by Howie.
Maybe so. I looked at Hester. Howie had a shotgun. Bill seemed to have been shot by a rifle. But could it have been a really close-range shotgun wound with just enough spread to make it look like an auto rifle? 12-gauge double-aught buckshot contained 9 balls of approximately .30 caliber, or 7.62 millimeter. That would make something smaller, like number one shot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.